talking about just in a different temple. See, Elijah was a temple of the Lord. So God spoke through Elijah. Moses was a temple of the Lord. So the Lord spoke through Moses. Every story you've ever read of your favorite leader, that was Jesus that did that. The bread of life. We are not God, we are vessels being used by God. Like in this moment, this was not Kiana that spoke to you, but the Holy Spirit. You get what I'm saying? See, there are some things that you just can't take credit for. See, Moses couldn't take credit for the things that he knew because it wasn't him that knew it. It was the Holy Spirit that dwelled in him that knew it. Remember, he told Moses, do not worry about what you are going to say, for the Holy Spirit will be there to what? To speak for him. Remember in the Bible, the Lord says, do not bring scribe, do not bring purse. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is going to speak on your behalf. See, too many times when we're spreading the gospel, we think that we got to have it all together. No. The Holy Spirit already knows what he wants to say, how he wants to say it, and who he wants to use to say it. God, exactly. God is looking at the heart. What is your heart like when you're doing these things? When you're out here spreading the word, what's your heart like? Because a person can have a corrupt heart, but speak good things out of their mouth. Even a snake knows how to be good to another snake. Don't miss that. I said, even a snake knows how to be kind to another snake. But it's still a snake. Still a snake. And I had to learn that. You want to know something I had to learn? I had to learn that I'm not a snake. I had to learn that I'm not a demon. I was pretending to be one to fit in. Let's talk about it. I pretended to be a demon to fit in because that's what everybody was doing. But this whole time, I never been a demon. I was always a light that was put here to guide people to Christ. See, when I grew up in the word, but I went astray. And when I went astray, that's when I started to try to be something that I wasn't. And it took me having to go through ups and downs for me to realize I'm not all what I've been portraying to be. God made me to be a lamp. God made me to be a tree, a freshly planted tree. Not a rotten tree, not a withered away tree. Because for a long time, I did not know my purpose. Now I know my purpose. Now I know my purpose. But my purpose came with a lot of ups and downs. A lot of bumpy roads, a lot of tearful nights, a lot of frustration. When you hear me speak, this doesn't come from something that happened overnight. But I boast in the Lord. Because through my darkest nights, he stayed with me. Remember in the Bible, it talks about Jesus eating with sinners. He was sitting with sinners. That's what God did with me. He sat with me. Me being a sinner and all, he still sat with me. And he taught me. And he loved on me. A sinner. being touched by the hand of God. The love that generates off of Christ is something that you can never find in the world. The acceptance that you get from Christ, you'll never find it in the world. And I can actually say that there is nothing that nobody can tell me to make me think otherwise, because I know Jesus is real. I don't believe that Jesus was a prophet. I don't believe that Jesus was just an extra man in the Bible. Jesus was God. He was the Lord of Lords. He was the King of Kings, and he was the God of Gods. And there is nothing, no one, that can change my mind on that. Because everything that God has showed me in the Spirit, it matches up with the Word of God. To the T. So can't nobody tell me to go read this Bible, go read that doctrine. Nah, I'm going to stick with the Holy Bible. Because I would have never got to where I am if it wasn't for this Holy Bible. I don't know about the missing books. I'm not going to speak about the missing books, baby. This right here is enough that these 66 books then got me where I need to be. Them 66 books is where I found Jesus Christ. This is everything I needed. When I wanted to talk to God, this is what I had. This is what I had. And I'm going to ask the Lord, in the presence of all of you, Father, if there's anything that you want to say to your children, Lord, we are listening. Lord, I thank you for allowing us to come together to worship in the fellowship in your name, Lord. You do it all the time. Each and every one of us is going through something, God. But for some reason, you have gathered us together to pour your Spirit into us, God, to pour your Word into us. And for this, Lord, we thank you, God. We magnify your name, God. We put no one before you, God. So, Lord, I ask you, Lord, speak to your children. Make those that are unbelievers, make them believers tonight, God. Only you can do it, God. Only you can do it, God. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray, we pray, amen. All right, hold on. The Lord gave me the Lord gave me 1 Corinthians chapter 4. The Lord just gave me 1 Corinthians chapter 4. I said chapter 4, not 13. Please take that down. And this is what the Lord wants us all to, this is what the Lord wants us all to hear. Let a man so consider us as servants of Christ and stewards of the mystery of God. Moreover, it is required in steward that one be found faithful. But with me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by a human court. In fact, I do not even judge myself, for I know of nothing against myself. Yet I am not justified by this, but he who judges me is the Lord. Therefore, judge nothing before the time until the Lord comes, who will both bring to light the hidden things of darkness and reveal the counsel of the hearts. Then each one praise will come from God. Now, this is what we were just talking about. How we are servants. We've come to serve. See, God knows how to make people believers. I don't have magical powers. God just uses who he wants to use. God is going to get his message out one way or another. If you want to be used, God will use you. He won't say, oh, you want to be used? No, not today. No, if you want to be used this very second, this very minute, this very hour, God will use you. And then it says this, verse 6. Now these things, brethren, I have figuratively transferred to myself and Apollos for your sake, that you may learn in us not to think beyond what is written, that none of you may be puffed up on behalf of one another for the other. Meaning, don't think of yourselves better than someone else. You may have a gift that person may not obtain. But do not think that you are better or that you stick your nose down at somebody just because you may be at a place that they're not at yet. Humble yourself is what it's saying. Humble yourself in the presence of God. Do not think of yourself better than another person. For in God's eyes, we're all equal. Then it says, verse 7, for who makes you differ from another? And what do you have that you did not receive? Now, if you did indeed receive it, why do you boast as if you had not received it? You are already full. You are already rich. You have reigned as kings without us. And indeed, I could wish you did reign, that we also might reign with you. For I think that God has displayed us, the apostles, last as men condemned to death. For we have been made a spectacle to the world, both to angels and to men. And what this is saying is to be fools for God. I'll look stupid for God. I'll look like a fool for God. I'll look like the biggest clown in your face for God. People like to say that people that talk about God have a mental problem. I'll be all that. I'll be that. It says, verse 10, we are fools for Christ's sake, but you are wise in Christ, because those that are fools for Christ are wise. Those that put their trust in the Lord are wise. See, you wise just because of your faith in Christ. Wise as a serpent, harmless as a dove. Correct. It says, we are weak, but you are strong. You are distinguished, but we are dishonored. To the present hour, we both hunger and thirst. We are poorly clothed and beaten and homeless. That's us. Some of us are beat down to the ground. We're waiting on our Savior. We are waiting for the King. And some of us are beaten up. Some of us got black eyes in the spirit because we've been wrestling and we've been fighting. But look at what the word says. It says, to the present hour, we both are poorly clothed and beaten and homeless. And we labor, working with our own hands. We're searching the scriptures. We're seeking the Lord. We're praying. We are trying to do whatever we can to get into contact with God. We are laboring. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Your labor is not in vain. Your labor is needed. Your testimony is needed. And it says, being reviled, we bless being persecuted. It's a wonderful thing to be persecuted. It's a wonderful thing to be persecuted. Because through your persecution comes faith. Through your persecution comes hope. Through your persecution comes a good character. Through your persecution, you start to look a little bit more like your father. So he says, we bless being persecuted. We endure being defamed. We entreat. We have been made as the filth of the world, the offspring of all things until now. We have been treated poorly. And the people that treated us poorly didn't even know that they were touching, mocking the sons and the daughters of the Most High. That's why you got to be careful putting your hands or your mouth or trying to defame someone's character, because you don't know what role they play in the kingdom. You don't know who's a watcher and who's not. You don't know who's a prophet of God and who's not. You don't know who's an apostle of God, who's an evangelist of God. You don't know who a disciple of God is, because they don't look like a disciple. What does a disciple even look like? What, a long church dress and a big old church hat? Like, how does a disciple really look? You don't have a specific look, because they come in all shapes and sizes. You have some that have clean face. Then you have some disciples that have tattoos all over their face. Exactly, a disciple looks like you and I. So this, you gotta look like a Christian. I don't even know where that came from. But at one point, we were poorly dressed. Our garments were filthy. And little by little, God was doing this. We came to God, we were filthy. God says, hey, give me your coat. Huh? Give me your coat. God then takes your coat and he starts washing it, scrubbing it, piece by piece. And then once he's done with your coat, he hangs your coat up to dry. And then he says, hey, let me get your shirt. Mind you, your shirt is filthy, mud all over it, filthy, sin all over it. And God says, give me your shirt. And you give him his shirt, your shirt. And he gets to scrubbing it by his hand. He's not using no machine. He's using his hands and he's scrubbing. And then he scrubs to the point where now it's white as snow, and he hangs that up. And then he says, okay, give me your pants. Starts scrubbing. And by the time he's done, you went from being one person dressed one way to now being clean, sanctified, and justified by the blood of the Lamb. But see, as he was washing your clothes, it was taking a little time. See, you just wanted him to put it on quick wash. You didn't know that he was going to wash you with his hands, his actual hands. You thought that God was going to put you in a quick little washer and dryer and put you on 34 minutes and hurry up and get you clean. You had no idea that he was washing you with his bare hands. Now you see why it took so long. Now you see why it took years. Because he was doing it by his hands. He didn't allow nobody to intervene. No, I'm going to wash them. Angels, step back. Powers, step back. Principalities, step back. I'm going to wash this vessel myself. So it took long because God said, I'm going to wash this vessel myself. The word also says we endure. Enduring means to continue to go about, not giving up. He's getting you prepared. Now you may ask yourself, why do we have to go through such a crucial preparation? Because this is the marriage of the supper of the Lamb. This is your introduction into your home. Imagine you have been waiting years for a house to get built. What if the builder said, hey, listen, because you want this house this way, this way, this way, it's going to take us some time, but we're going to get the job done. It's just going to take a while because we want to lay it brick by brick. We don't want no problems with this house. So what God did was God took you and built you brick by brick, layer by layer. And it took a while, but now you're starting to see the fruit. And you're not even done yet. God still got some bricking to do, some layering to do. But where you're at right now, you can now see the fruit of everything that you had went through. Before, you didn't see it. Before, you like, okay, I'm going through this storm. I don't know what's going on. Then somehow God calmed the storm. He said, peace be still. And for a second, he allowed you to get a glimpse over your life. And you started to see that you don't do things you used to do. You don't talk the way you used to talk. Now you got a heart. Now you have compassion for people. Now when you say you love people, you really love people. Now when you say you forgive people, you really forgive people. So God allowed peace to be still so that you could look and see what God is actually doing in your life. See, you thought that God wasn't doing nothing because you couldn't see it right then and there. So God had to pause everything around you and allow you to just sit and ponder on that thing. And now you see that God's hand was on it all along. Because now you're starting to put 1 + 1 together. You're starting to put 2 + 2 together. And it's starting to equal up how God said that it would equal up. And now you're like, oh, this is the reason why you caused this person to leave out of my life. Oh, this is the reason why you told me to be still in this situation. Okay, this is why that now it's starting to make sense. God cares. It's all coming together for the greater good. It's all coming together for the greater good. I know it don't seem like it, but it's all coming together for the greater good. See, in order for you to see the promised land, you got to keep walking. So you got to remember, you're walking through the desert. When you get in the desert, when you get in the wilderness, there's no shade. There's no water. There's nothing. The only shade that you'll get is being in connection with the Lord. See, when the people were following Moses, they were complaining. They were saying how hungry they were, how thirsty they were. And even though they were in the wilderness, God still gave them a way to get water. and bits of bread. Manna. It said that the manna fell from heaven. The bread, the word of God, fell down from heaven and strengthened the people to continue to endure. What you think that was meant for? When God said that manna started flowing from heaven, God sent his word, and his word encouraged them to keep going. What do you think God's doing with you right now? God knows that we are in the very end of this long journey that we've been journeying for 40 years. What would have took us 11 days took us 40 years because of our disobedience. And now we're finally at the end. You're at the end. And it would be a shame to wait until you get to the very end to give up. But see, God is so good that he's, even if you was to try to do that, God wouldn't let it slide. God says, I didn't bring you all this far to have you say in my face, you give up. You can't get away from me that easy. You're going to finish this race. Because that's how I programmed you. That's how I made you. That's how I formed you to never give up. I knew when I was creating you that I was going to send you into the world as my light. Listen. When God was creating you, he already knew his plans for you. I know my plans that I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you. So when God was molding you, God already knew who you would be, who you would become. He knew where he was going to place you and what family he was going to place you. He knew every route that you would take, the good and the bad. He knew it, but he knew that the end result would be you and him. So even though you fell off a couple of times, even though you've made a couple mistakes, your destination is still the same. You made it. Now don't take it for granted. Don't boast in self, because it's not you that got you here. It was the mercy, the love of God that got you here. Because you wouldn't have made it if it wasn't for Christ. You know how much the devil was up after you? Some of you don't even know what you were fighting up against. You had Goliaths in front of you and you didn't even notice. You had serpents and dragons and you had all types of stuff fighting up against you, girl, fighting up against your man. You don't even know what God was protecting you from. Just because you couldn't see it, you thought you was good. You don't even know that there's a many a day you could have died. And God said, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. God has protected you all this way. You think he gonna stop now? Because you messed up? Because you backslid? You think he, everything you, come on now, think about it. Think about it. Everything that you went through that God didn't got you through, you think because you messed up this time that he gonna take his hand off of you after y'all done came all this way, y'all done reached the end now. If God was gonna give up on you, he would have did it some miles ago. He would have did it some years ago. If he wasn't gonna use you, he would have been cut you off. He would have been let the devil have you if that was the case. God's plan was never to kick you to the curb. God's plan was never to destroy you. God's plan was never to give up on you. That wasn't the plan. The plan was to keep pressing you, keep molding you until you become the person that you were meant to be. Remember, pressure makes diamonds. I want you to remember that. Pressure make diamonds. And sometimes you gotta be pressed. Sometimes you gotta be squeezed for you to come into the person that God created you to be. in order for you to know you're anointed, you're going to have to go through some sorrow. You're going to have to go through some grief. Because for too long, you've been thinking everything that people have said about you. That's how you. That's how some of you look at yourself. You don't look at yourself like you're anointed. You look at yourself like every bad thing somebody has ever said about you. You think that's you. So if they called you fat, if they called you stupid, if they call you slow, then that's what you think that you are. You are not fat. You are not stupid. You are not slow. You are not